think we're off the camera film. Good morning.
Rise up.
If somebody could gather the people in the gather, not really what we call it, but gather them in, that would be great. All right, let's stand. We'll go ahead and get started. They'll come in as they can. Thank you all for being here on this holiday weekend. We appreciate it so much. And the freedom that we are able to rejoice in is, freedom for our country, freedom for those who died for us, but especially freedom because Jesus died for us. And this song, we just love it because just like he called Lazarus out of the grave, he calls us away from our sin, out of that grave of sin, and it says, rise up. Sing it with us. Because Jesus breaks our chains. He's the chain breaker.
Yeah. that, I hope the words of that song are true, don't y'all? I think I'm on. Am I on? Can you hear me? Frankly, I wonder if David had had a week like I had and he heard these words. Have you ever had a week like this? Do I have that verse up there, Mark? There. You ever had a week like this? I said, if I only had wings like a dove, I'd fly away and find rest. I hope that I had a week like that this week. I'm out of here. If I just had wings, I'd be gone and find rest. That was verse 6 of Psalm 55, and at the end of verse 55, this was David battling with his enemies. I don't know what your enemy is. And he said, I was out of here. I'm ready to go. If I had wings, I would fly away and find rest. You'd find me. I don't know where you'd find me. You wouldn't be around here. I'll tell you that right now. I'd be gone. In verse 23, I didn't have that up there. I looked after I heard that song. I'm thinking, yeah, Clayton, that's the kind of week you have. What happens in the end? Are the truth of those words, that song, are they true or not? At the end, the psalmist says, God, you will bring them down to the pit of destruction. My enemies, when I have a week like that and I'm ready to fly away, jump on a motorcycle and take off, and I don't know where I might land at. There's a promise at the end of that song. God, you'll bring them down to the pit of destruction. Men of bloodshed and treachery will not live out half their days, but I will trust in you. Anybody else want to just whisper amen? Father, we come this morning to this place of worship, and we proclaim with our mouths that you're bigger and better and greater and stronger than the mountains of our lives. Those mountains that stand before us that seem impossible. Father, you are bigger and better and greater and stronger than the enemies that stand in front of us. Father, you are bigger and better and greater and stronger than all of the apparent, the hurdles that are in front of us that seem insurmountable. I can never get over this hurdle. But we proclaim, Father, the words of this song that you, with our mouths, sometimes our hearts don't feel it, but with our mouths we proclaim, God, that you, come on church, you are bigger and better and greater and stronger than all of those things in our lives. Church, say amen.
Amen.
So, Father, we have bothered this morning to get out of bed and to exercise the discipline of worship and come to this place. It's dedicated to you for the purpose of worship. Here we are, Lord. You tell us that where two or three are gathered in your name, that you are here in the midst of us. Wow. Thank you, Father, that you would stop what you are doing and you would lend your ear to hear our prayers. So we offer our prayers to you this morning. I would like to offer one prayer. And the reason I'd like to offer it, because it seems impossible. And that is that Dwayne Turner said last week to Bootsy, I sure would like to go to church. That's impossible. Except, Father, that nothing is impossible with you. And so, Father, right now we call out to you those mountains that are before us. Father, would you speak to those mountains and tell those mountains, move out of the way and open up a pathway. Open up an opportunity. Open up something that didn't exist before. Create, Father, in our lives roadways where there used to be mountains. We believe that you can do it. Hear our prayers now as we call them up to you. Amen. 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 Father, when we want to flee, when we want to just run away and get up away from it all, God, this week we would ask you that you would reveal yourself bigger, better, greater, stronger than all of these enemies that we find in our lives. Would you help us this week, I pray. We commit this day to you and we thank you, Father. We proclaim your greatness and your power and your glory. You are worthy, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Maybe that's why God made roses.
pretty beautiful words to all those songs. Aren't those powerful and inspiring words? And then we get to open up and we get to look at God's word, inspired by his breath himself. The breath of God inspired. Let me just make a little note here to start with. Today we celebrate officially, Church 247 is 8.5 years old. Thank you. We started on the first Sunday of 2015, and we just finished June, which is 6 months of our 8th year. We're in the middle of our 9th year. I do this every week, and I just feel compelled to share our Since Last Week segment. Got a couple of pictures from the camp on Wednesday night. It was a pizza, shaved ice, and watermelon. Social. Where the church got together. We got together on Wednesday night and we fellowshiped, we socialized, and we happened to do so in the heat around shaved ice. I would like to say thank you to the nursery of Church 247 for their faithfulness to the church events. Amen. There's Maddie. What's she got? She's got pizza there, and there's Hendrix, shaved ice. Right there's Josh and Caitlin and Brody and their niece. There's a bunch of family. Hang on. That is a video. Would you swap the cable real quick, Mark? I meant to tell you, it was a pretty crazy morning this morning. In fact, it was such a crazy morning, I didn't get water. Tyler, would you mind getting me a little bottle of water out back there? Well, we got that plug. It's a 21-second video from Wednesday night. That's the cheering section. That's the baseball, that's the kickball game.
No. Get there.
And there's the shaved ice truck. And there's Otis wishing he had some. That was Wednesday night. Didn't that look like fun? It was great fun. Thank you, Tom. Goodbye. Well, you saw Sammy at the camp on Wednesday night. To the untrained eye, that may not be like us, look like a significant picture right there. But Samuel is sitting up. Look at Samuel sitting up, turning and looking at his mama with that smile on his face. I keep saying Samuel knows something we don't know. Because he's got that face on that picture on his face all the time. That showed up a couple of days. I don't know if you were aware of the physical conditions that Samuel Tedrick has, but I'm going to tell you right now, that picture right there is a picture of God at work in Samuel Tedrick's life. Amazing. Amazing. Samuel doesn't just sit up. And I've got one more picture I want to show. This was from Tuesday at prayer time. At prayer time, in every single week, I'm sitting across the street working. Otis looks and sees people headed for prayer, and he begs to go to prayer time. On Tuesday, he and Muggsy took off, and they went to prayer time, and there is a picture of them with River. Perhaps that is the last picture we will ever have of Muggsy. On Wednesday afternoon, I was in my office, or I was on the front porch about to go to my office to teach a class. I looked at my watch and it was 3:19. I was on the front porch. And I said, I got to get back into my office to start the class at 3:30. 3:19. At 4:15, Hope came home from work that day. Between 3:19 and 4:15 on Wednesday afternoon, Muggsy disappeared. We've had him in our home since he was a little gray puffball puppy. He bounced around and threw toys, and we've had him for 13 years. He has been our puppy dog. On Tuesday, perhaps, Jill said she'd be watching. I'm not sure. Hey, Jill. On Tuesday afternoon, perhaps the very last picture we will have of Muggsy was of him at prayer time. And that appropriate? Hope had ordered this, I think, to give me for Father's Day. It came in, she gave it to me yesterday or Friday. Every snack you make, every meal you bake, every bite you take, we'll be watching you. And it was a picture of Otis and Muggsy, and she gave it to me. It came in on Friday, and we lost Muggsy on Wednesday. We haven't seen him since Wednesday. You know me, I don't air a lot of our laundry. I'm not up here to get sympathy. I'm just telling you that's kind of what happened in our life. Hope has socialized it all over the network, her social networks. She laminated a bunch of posters and took them out and put them all over the neighborhood. She's called the veterinarian. She's taken a copy of the poster and given the veterinarian. And we've cried and we've prayed. And he's beautiful. He's a beautiful puppy dog. But he's 13 years old and he has real bad arthritis and he doesn't hear good. I don't know who stole him, but they didn't get an especially good value. I'm just saying. Except to us. And I can promise you this, if he was taken by someone else, right now, you can go to that next one, Mark. Right now, he is sitting at the door. You saw this picture a couple weeks ago where we were out there socializing. He was sitting in the yard looking toward the house, longing for home. I can tell you right now that our little Muggsy is sitting in somebody's house looking at the door, longing for home. So it's been a hard week for us. We thank you for your prayers. And we ask you to continue to pray for us. So I'll be transparent with you. Perhaps as we start the beginning of the second half of our ninth year, 8.5 years old, perhaps I have spent less time preparing for today's sermon than any sermon in the last 8.5 years. Perhaps this was an appropriate week for us for an appropriate story for the passage of Scripture that we're going to look at this week in our series, What Did Jesus Say? What did Jesus tell us? I got done with the message. It was just a little hard this week. Back then in the Bible times in Mark chapter 2, Saturday or the Sabbath day, that was the day people came to worship. Today we worship on Sunday. Back then the Jews did it on the Sabbath, which was Saturday. And they didn't come to church. They went to synagogue. Synagogue means a place of worship. It was the Sabbath day. And they had been to synagogue. And Jesus and his disciples had a brutal schedule traveling around. Someone always had a need. Someone was always wanting something from Jesus. So will you join with me in Mark chapter 2? We'll start with verse 23 this morning. On the Sabbath, he was going through the grain fields. On the Sabbath, I'm telling you what now, folks. You understand, it's the Sabbath day, Miss Debbie. This is the day of worship. We get that verse on the Sabbath. That's the Sea of Galilee, by the way. On the Sabbath day, he was going through the grain fields, and his disciples began to make their way picking some heads of grain. On the Sabbath day. Last week, we saw that Jesus got in trouble because his disciples weren't fasting. I'm telling you what, John's disciples fast and the Pharisees' disciples fast. Why aren't your people fasting, Jesus? And Jesus said, because they got the groom with them. They got God right here in their presence. They don't have any reason to be sad. This week, it's on the Sabbath day. And the disciples began picking their way, walking their way, picking heads of grain. We'll get to this in a few weeks, but I want you just to see the context of their ministry and jump ahead to Mark chapter 6. He said to them, guys, look, we've had a brutal, hectic schedule. We're going from absolute dawn till dusk, people everywhere meeting needs. Let's get away. He said to them, come away by yourselves to a remote place and rest for a while. For many people were coming and going, and they didn't even have time to eat. Now it's the Sabbath day. They've been to Sabbath worship at the synagogue, and church is over with, and they are hungry. And they walk out of the synagogue, and there happens to be a field right next door that has some wheat in it, and they begin walking through, picking heads of wheat. I imagine they're probably doing it like this. I mean, they're probably scarfing it in. Verse 24 of Mark chapter 2, the Pharisees said to him, look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath. Don't you know there's a rule that says you can't pick grain on the Sabbath? Why are your disciples picking grain on the Sabbath? Don't they know that that's not lawful? Now, what in the world? Where would that come from? Well, let me just jump back to Deuteronomy. We'll jump a bunch. Let me jump back to Deuteronomy so you can see the rule. This was the rule in the book of Deuteronomy, the 23rd chapter and the 24th and 25th verses. When you enter your neighbor's vineyard, you may eat as many grapes as you want until you're full. But don't take any 5-gallon buckets with you and pick grapes off. You can't just steal people's grapes from them. But when you're walking through, you can get some grapes. Verse 25, when you enter your neighbor's standing grain, you may pluck heads of grain with your hand, but don't put a sickle to your neighbor's grain. In other words, don't bring your tractor over and start harvesting grain. But if you're walking through their field and there's heads of grain there, you can take what heads of grain you want. So I ask you the question, was it unlawful? No, not according to Deuteronomy. They were walking through the field, there was grain there. So what was the rub? On Sabbath day that they were collecting heads of grain. That's where the rub was at. Last week it was, why aren't your disciples fasting? This week, what are your disciples doing? They're doing the unlawful on the Sabbath. I'm reminded of what Hope's dad used to say. She told me, I didn't hear him say it. As a pastor, she used to say that her dad would say, some people are against sliced bread. You know anybody like that? They're against everything. It doesn't matter what it is. They're against eating heads of grain on the Sabbath. They're against not fasting when you ought to. They're against everything. They're just, everything that comes up, they're just against it. Her dad used to say, some people are against sliced bread. Her dad also used to tell the story about the business meeting at church that got pretty intense. They were discussing on and voting about how, about whether or not that they would purchased chandeliers for the church. The discussion got very intense until finally one old gentleman stood up and he said, I tell you, I'm 100% against wasting our money on those chandeliers. What we need around here is some new lights. If you didn't get it, ask your neighbor, he'll give it to you at lunch. Some folks you just can't ever please. They're always going to naysay or gripe or have an excuse or make some religious-sounding statement intended to thwart your efforts, especially if it was Jesus or his disciples. No doubt Jesus knew Deuteronomy 23. He knew whether or not it was lawful. He knew every single last word of Deuteronomy and Leviticus and Genesis and all of them. He was the Word. So he responds to them in a remarkably clever way like Jesus does. First, let me remind you, if you were a Jew and you were living at this time, King David was a hero, Coda. King David was the man. In fact, all of Jerusalem, all of Israel was looking for somebody else to rise back up and take King David's place and deliver them from the Romans. King David was the man. He was the hero. He could do no wrong in their eyes. Do you have it? Jesus reminds them about King David. Let me set the stage for you so you see it. Let's jump ahead then to Leviticus. In the tabernacle or in the tent, the temporary place of worship, they didn't have a building like this. They had a tent. And in the tent, they had a bunch of different places, one of which was a table. And on that table, they had what they called the showbread, S-H-E-W, the showbread. It was 12 loaves of bread, symbolic of the 12 clans, Israel's 12 sons. One loaf of bread for each of the clans, each of the families. And that bread was there in the tabernacle, and nobody was to eat that bread except for the high priest and his Aaron and his sons. Nobody was to eat of the showbread except the priest. Nobody. This was the showbread. This was the special bread. There was a rule that said nobody eats the bread except for the priest. Leviticus chapter 24, the bread is to be set out before the Lord every Sabbath day as a permanent covenant obligation on the part of the Israelites. That means there's a rule there. It belongs to Aaron and his sons who are to eat it in a holy place. for it is the holiest portion for him from the food offerings to the Lord. This is a permanent rule. You got it? There's a rule there. We got a rule in place. Nobody can eat the bread off the table except the priests. You got that? Now watch what Jesus does. He comes back to the story. And he says to them, by the way, you can read this in 1 Samuel 21. This is what happens. But Jesus says to them in verse 25, this is what Jesus said to them when they said, hey, it's not lawful for your disciples to eat on the Sabbath. He said to them, guys, y'all remember your hero, King David? Have you never read what David and those who were with him did when he was in need and hungry? How he entered the house of God in the time of Abiathar the high priest, and he ate the bread of the presence? Let me just summarize if you miss it. He broke the rule. The rule was nobody eats the bread of the presence except the priest and son. Do y'all not remember that your hero King David went into the temple and he ate the bread of the presence? Which, and look, I underlined it here again because that's the same thing that the Pharisees said a minute ago. They said it's not lawful for your guys to walk through the fields. Jesus said to them, that's not lawful for anyone to eat except the priest. And he also gave some to his companions. And now those Pharisees are in a pickle. Because King David is their hero. And Jesus just pointed out how King David broke a rule. And now they're accusing Jesus and his disciples of breaking a rule. What in the world are we going to do? We're stuck now, the people, the Pharisees would say. Let me just give you this little short one-liner. You ready? You can write this down. I don't have notes today. The rule was violated in favor of life. Think about it. There was a rule out there that you can't eat bread. If David and his men had not eaten that bread, they'd been out to war and they were about to starve to death. If the priest said, sorry, hate it, that's just for us and my sons, can't eat of it, they would have starved to death. The rule was violated in favor of life. Chew on it for a minute. In fact, Jesus was saying to them, you guys, you Pharisees, would rather these men starve in order to keep some rule than you would allow them to live. Now, I just tell you, some of y'all have been in church all your life. Some of you know all the rules. Some of you know about the chandelier. Some of you know about the red carpet. Some of you know about the crazy stuff that we've done. Jesus would say, and maybe you'd just see somebody starve to death if they would break one of your little sacred rules that you have. And so he delivers to them the punchline in verse 27. Y'all, you got it completely upside down. You all somehow think that man was created in order to obey some Sabbath rule. But you upside down. He told them, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Now let me just say, more to the point, somehow you guys imagine that God gave to mankind a command about the Sabbath so you would have something to hold over people's heads. You couldn't be more wrong. You've heard me say it many times in these passages about the Sabbath. And you can write this one down. The law of the Sabbath is not a rule to keep. It is a gift to enjoy. You see it? It's 180 degrees difference. They were treating it like it was a rule. Man wasn't made to obey the Sabbath. The Sabbath was given to man as a gift. Remember what God did. How long did God work?
6 days.
Remember that? Remember this, 6 days shalt thou labor. Now there's a rule to be followed. 6 days you gotta work. Don't be slack. But the seventh day is a special day. It is set aside. It's the one I'm giving you to rest, and I'm commanding you. I'm giving you an order, Forrest. Take a day of rest. Work hard on those 6 days. But But I'm giving to you a gift on that seventh day, and I'm giving you a commandment. Take the day of rest. Enjoy the gift that I have given you. It was made for you. You weren't made for it. Take the gift. Do something different. Don't work. And then they all got worked up about what it meant on the Sabbath. And then Jesus says, and go back up, I'm sorry, I want to get back to verse 28. Then Jesus says, y'all, I know what I'm talking about. I know what I'm talking about, Sabbath. The reason I know what I'm talking about is because I am the Lord. I am the master. I am the boss. I am the chief. I am the Lord of the Sabbath. So then the Son of Man is a phrase out of Daniel. Everybody, all the Pharisees knew that that meant that Jesus was calling himself God. Jesus says, I am God. I am the Lord of everything. I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. If I say it, it's true. I'm saying that I'm Lord even of the Sabbath day. Not only am I a Lord of the Sabbath day, I'm also Lord of Sunday, and I'm the Lord of Monday, and Tuesday's mine, and Wednesday belongs to me, and Thursday's my day, and Friday's my day. They're all my days. I am the Lord of the Sabbath. And I'm right here before you, and I'm giving you my words. Imagine that Jesus turned to his disciples while they were kind of they probably had a head of wheat in their hand looking like, should we drop it or what do we do? Or I don't know what Jesus is going to say. And are the Pharisees right? And I imagine Jesus looked at them, smiled, and said, enjoy your lunch. Enjoy your lunch, guys. This is new stuff, this stuff that Jesus is teaching. And he's saying it, it's not going to fit in your old dried up wine skins. I'm pouring new stuff in. This stuff will set you free. This stuff will make you get on the stage and jump and you do cartwheels and you're good. This is new stuff that gives you life. The rules would trap you and keep you. I'm here to give you life and to give it to you more abundantly. This is new stuff. Title of the message, Rest. The notion of rest is present in all of Scripture from the very beginning. Let me go back now, Mark, to these. You remember when it started. So the heavens and the earth and everything in them were completed. On the seventh day, God had completed his work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. God blessed that day, the seventh day, and declared it holy or different, for on it he rested from all of his work. And you see this tight connection, inextricable connection between the Sabbath that day and the notion of rest. And we see the Sabbath all in the Old Testament. We see it talked about. We see rest talked about in the Old Testament. We can hardly talk about rest, though, and not hear these words from Jesus in Matthew chapter 11. Y'all, Jay, come to me. All you who are weary and burdened, and I'll give you. Take my yoke upon you. Now, if you were a donkey or a mule, you'd have a yoke around your shoulders. The rules were a yoke, and the rules will weigh you down, and they'll just prove to you you can't keep the rules. So Jesus says, yes, there's a yoke, but I'm going to tell you, take my yoke and learn from me, because I'm lowly and humble, and you'll find rest for your souls. Because my yoke, what I'm asking you to do, Alan, what I'm asking you to do is easy. And the burden I'm placing on your life is light. Come to me and I'll give you rest. The notion of rest. And I'm going to tie it back into the Sabbath in just a minute pretty remarkably. Come to me, follow me, and I'll give you rest. I just put in here, you can just, everybody just sigh. Clayton, you mean I don't have to have it all right? That's right. You mean whenever, we talked this morning in Sunday school, we were talking about grief, the five stages of grief, and I'll just kind of tell you right now, this is just transparently, maybe it's off the record, Clayton and Hope, we're in that angry stage right now in grief, because somebody took our dog. and I don't know who it was, but I want to punch him in the mouth. I'm just saying, oh, it's off the record, Robert. That's not very pastoral.
It's okay. It's human.
Thank you. Here, can I tell you, let me just go off the script just for a second and tell you, this is how Hope and I are dealing with it. Hope quoted this verse the other night. This was Jesus talking, and he said, not even a bird of the air falls to the ground without your Father knowing it. So, you know what our prayer's been? Lord, we took care of Moses and somebody stole him. Now you want to have to take care of him, but we can't. If you can take care of the bird that falls from the sky and you know about it and you care about it, you're going to have to take care of our little Moses. Because we can't. And We rest in that. We rest in that truth. It's not just some Bible blobby, blobby, blobby. It works in our lives, the truth does. Finally, the author of Hebrews brings it to our living room. He goes on and he talks about rest for a couple of chapters. The writer of Hebrews, we're going to go there in just a second. It's deep and it's rich and it's full, and you're probably going to have to sit down and read it two or three times and maybe get a commentary to help you understand it because it is deep and it's rich. But I want to pluck out a couple of verses out of Hebrews chapter 3 and chapter 4 and tie together the notion of the Sabbath and the rest. Verse 7, therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, and let me just say it. On July 1, 2023, I'm just going to say it to every person in this room. Today, if you hear his voice speaking to you, don't harden your heart. If you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. Don't harden your hearts as in the rebellion. What was the rebellion? As in the testing of the wilderness. Here was the rebellion. God said, hey, Israel, I have this land over here and I am giving it to you. And they said, but it's too hard. There's too many enemies. We can't take the land. And God said, but I have given it to you as a gift. Don't harden your hearts as they did back in the rebellion on the day of testing in the wilderness. Go to verse 9. Where your ancestors tested me and they tried me. They saw my works. They saw me part the Red Sea. They saw everything that I did for 40 years. So I was provoked to anger with that generation and said, they always go astray in their hearts and they have not known my ways. Those people were so cotton-picking, hard-hearted, I tried to give them a land and they wouldn't take it. Verse 11. So I swore in my anger, they're not going to enter my rest. If they want to harden their heart and not believe me and not follow me, I'm going to let them wander around for 40 years. And I'm not going to let them enter into my rest. I've given them the gift. I've told them to take possession of the gift. But if they're not going to believe me and they're going to harden their hearts and not obey me and not do what I ask them to do, they're just simply not going to enter into my rest. You start to see that it's really a heart problem, right? The rest that he's talking about is not some obedience to some rule about one of their days of the week. Instead, it is the rest that's found in believing God. God had promised his people rest in the land that he'd given them. It was his gift to them, go take possession of the land. But in their hearts, in their unbelief, they hardened their hearts, and they were never going to enter the rest. Wow. Just to make sure that I'm connecting this with the Sabbath back in Mark chapter 2. That's Hebrews 3. I'm going to go to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 4. For somewhere in the Bible, it's almost like tongue-in-cheek, the writer says, somewhere he has spoken about the seventh day in this way, and on the seventh day God rested. The writer of Hebrews ties the seventh day to this notion of rest. By the way, some people would say that we are living right now on planet Earth in the seventh day. God did all of his work, and the seventh day is now planet Earth, and we are living out the seventh day right now. And then he's going to come back and make all things new. Maybe that's Monday morning. Maybe that's the next day for him. He's going to start it. Maybe that's the next day in the Lord's great big calendar. I don't know. Somewhere he has spoken on the seventh day, God rested from his work. And then I'll close with this beautiful challenge. Verse 9 of the same chapter. Therefore, Sabbath rest remains for God's people. Bryson, there is a Sabbath rest available for God's people. A rest. It's a rest. It's not a time of struggle. It's not a time of worry. It's not a time of trying to figure your life out. It's not a time of focusing on yourself and your good deeds or your bad times. It's a time of rest. It's available to God's people. For the person, verse 10, the person who has rested from his own works. Now, I'm going to tell you what. If you're here today and you're trusting in your own works, you're under a heavy load. Some of you know what that's like. Some of you have been there. Some of us have been there trying to rest and trust in your own works. If you've done that, you're under a heavy load. The person who's entered his own rest has rested from his own works just as God did from here. I'm not depending on my works anymore. I'm now depending on his. Today, may I ask, are you at rest? Are you depending on your works? Today, Jesus offers you rest. Rest for your body. Yeah, there's something good about taking a day off. I believe it still applies to today. Take a day off and get some rest. But it's more than rest for your body. It's rest for your mind and your heart and your soul that are restless and are restless. Even when somebody has the audacity to steal your cotton picking, it'll be done. How do you get there? Last verse. It's the first part of verse 3 of that same chapter. For we who have believed enter the rest. There's really just one question for all of us. That is, have you believed? Have you believed God? Have you taken God in his word? Do you trust him with your life? Do you trust him with your children? Do you trust him with your puppy dog? Do you trust him with your finances? Do you trust him with your sin? Do you trust him with your hurts and your habits and your hang-ups? Do you trust him with everything? For we who have believed, we get to put our hands in our pockets. And we get to enter into the rest that he has promised us. So I will just ask you today in your hearts and your soul and your minds, today, if the Lord spoke to you, don't harden your heart. Instead, come to him in belief and enter into his amazing rest. Will you pray with me? Lord, I know it's no accident. I know that you know that Clayton and Hope Houchins, this week we needed this passage of Scripture. Father, we really, really want to believe, and we want to trust you, and we want to experience your rest and your peace and your joy. Father, I pray for someone here this morning whose heart and mind has not been at rest. Maybe you're speaking to them today. If you're speaking to them, I pray they won't harden their hearts. I pray that they will open their hearts and minds and say, yes, that's what I want. That's what I need in my life. I need rest for my soul. I pray that someone today, Father, would have the courage to believe you, trust you, come to rest. The song that we're going to sing, the line in it is, bring it all to the table. Imagine that table spread before us. God, whatever it is in your life, hurts, habits, hang-ups, sin, shame, past, guilt, regret, worry, anxiety, lost dog, wayward child, difficult marriage. Bring it all to the table. The Lord would call you today. Will you stand with me, Mark? Play that song, All on the Table. Bring it off. I'll be glad to meet you here and talk to you. Just come and pray on your own.
Hear the voice of love that's calling. There's a chair that waits for you. Everything you're going through.
Invitation to you, doesn't he? And he keeps calling us to himself. When we put our heads on the pillows at night, you know what he's doing? He's speaking to us and he's calling us. Whatever you got, bring it to me and I'll take care of it. I will replace that with rest for your souls. Be seated. The kids are coming in whenever they're ready. By the way, they opened that door back there and they put a big fan there to blow some cooler air because it's cooler back there than it is here. Is it warm in here to y'all? Not as bad as it was last week, I don't think. Are the kids close? How? Did you see any kids wandering around back there? Let me go ahead and share a couple of announcements with you. By the way, check your bulletin. They should all be there. Jim is the elder of the week. Call him. Today at 5:00, we're having barbecue at the camp. I started to say this morning that I started to get whoever's bringing the buns for this afternoon to bring 12 packs of buns and lay them out here on the table as the show bread, but I didn't. We're at barbecue. Church is providing for the barbecue. I say church, there's a couple people cooking barbecue. Us for one, the house smells great. I think it's going to be good. And somebody has ordered a gallon of slaw from Peach Blossom, amen. But if you'll bring other sides, is it going to be hot there today?
Yes, absolutely.
Will we probably have water in case you need to cool off? We probably will. 5:00, let me just remind you that this is an opportunity for us to bring in church people to come out there and just see us have fun. We've had some folks that just kind of come and visited. It's a great time to bring in church folks. Next one. We're not going to have service this week on Wednesday night. We've been meeting at the camp. The Tuesday, huh? Well, that was the prayer time. No prayer time this week. No Wednesday night activities because of the 4th of July. Feed the neighbors. By the way, the blue bowl is right here. If you want to bring some money up, drop it in right here. We will feed the neighbors. That's our code word for folks who are less fortunate than us. We'll be doing that next Saturday, right? It's the 8th, okay. Faith Home on July 20th, Israel, and Crystal will be speaking if you want to see Lori for tickets to that coming up in just a few weeks. Vacation Bible School, have any of you all remembered to take the little toilet paper or paper towel cardboard things and bring them to Aubrey or to Lori or to the church? I remember, thank you, Kate, with Kate back. Yeah, look at that, up there with the video. I hear you, my brother. We remember to bring four this week. So July 23rd through 26th is Vacation Bible School. Excited about that. Hey, where did y'all come from? So let me get off the side. I don't have a microphone. Anybody? Test. Brody, can I ask you? I had the question written down. What did you learn about today?
About Jonah swallowed the whale.
Jonah swallowing the whale. Amen. Singing line, do you want to sing? Jackson, yeah.
Judah got swallowed by a whale. Jonah got swallowed by a whale. And he prayed to God and he got spit out of the whale.
Let me ask you a question, Alden. Did Jonah have to get swallowed up in the belly of a whale? Could he have done something to where he didn't get swallowed up by the whale to start with? Start with, amen. Is that what you said, Oliver? Amen. Who had Luke? You got some for us?
Yes.
All right, go for it. So I got the last question: is did Jonah start listening to God after the whale spit him out?
Yes.
And what did he do? Did y'all cover that? Where did he go? Did y'all? Israel, did y'all cover that today? What happened after he got spit out of the well? Huh? That wasn't in the lesson. Well, here's the rest of the story. Y'all ready? We're going to finish Sunday school. Luke is back. I'm looking. This is going to be good. You ready? After the well spit Jonah out, Jonah went and did what God said. He went and preached to that town, and God saved the whole town. The church said?
Amen.
Amen. So that's the rest of the story. Do you think they got their sticker for this week, huh? That's July 2nd. They're halfway there. The summer at the sea. Yeah, we got to, let's see now. Just make sure we got it right. Well, I'm not even going to go back there. Any other thing, young people? Kids who first said, anything else to share? All right, you all may go. You're dismissed. Thank you very much. Anything? Let me take 15 seconds and just say to you, Clayton knows in his spiritual journey with God, he knows what it's like to wrestle and wrestle and wrestle and wrestle, thinking he's doing the right thing. But I'm going to tell you today, Clayton knows what it's like to rest. It's all about what God's grace has done for me. It's not about me. It's not about my hard work. It's not about my efforts. It's all about God's grace. And he says, why don't you just put your hands in your pockets and enjoy my rest. Amen. Will you stand with me? Let's pray. Yes, it's going to be hot. Yes, there'll probably be at least water guns, if not a sprinkler fountain thingy for this afternoon. Yes, we will have barbecue and a bunch of it. And I think some folks are bringing fireworks. I don't know what time you shoot fireworks. I would make one request. Can I please get to the house in time to give Otis some medicine before we do fireworks? He just does like that. Plus, he misses his brother really bad. Thank you for your prayers. Were you going to say something? How you got a microphone?
No, I sing.
Oh, you sing. Okay. You sing? Are you one of those singers? Let's pray together.